So another new model that got released towards the end of last week was Vicuna. The word open source used very loosely at the moment with these models, but they're calling it an open source chatbot impressing GPT-4 with 90% ChatGPT quality. So we'll talk about what that actually means in a second. So this comes out from a group of people from a number of prestigious institutions in America who've been working on these kinds of things. The first thing to note about this, so I'm going to talk a little bit about the model. We'll have a look at the model and we'll look at there's a scandal around the data set for the model as well, because it turns out the model is just like so many of the other ones that we've looked at already. It's basically just fine-tuning a llama model. So they take a llama model and then fine-tune it. Now, in this case, they've taken the bigger 13 billion llama model and they've fine-tuned it. And what they've fine-tuned it on is pretty interesting. So they've fine-tuned it on this data set of conversations that are taken from ChatGPT. And actually, they're taken from a site called ShareGPT. So if we look up what ShareGPT is, this is a site where people can post different conversations and you can see, you know, okay, what actually the ChatGPT conversation was, etc. And it turns out up until recently, this site had a huge number of conversations that were easy to access and that you could do searches for, I think. They had an explore page, all this kind of stuff. Now, that's all gone, right? We'll talk about in a minute why it's gone. But let's get back to a vicuna. So vicuna, I think, is an animal that's kind of similar to an alpaca, a llama. Pretty soon they're going to run out of animals for names for these models. But anyway, this is another one. Like I said, it's tuned from llama. And they've benchmarked it using an interesting kind of way of looking at it. So what they've done is they've basically taken something and done a generation, and they do the generation with a llama model, with an alpaca model, with Bard, and with ChatGPT, and they feed this into GPT-4 with this prompt and get it to generate a score for each of these. So not surprisingly, llama comes out the lowest by itself because it's not really tuned, you know, there's no real fine tuning done for instructions with that model, or very little of that done. So they find that alpaca does well, but then vicuna does way better, right? And gets very close to Bard when they do their tests. And then of course, ChatGPT is going to score 100% because that's what they're trying to get like. So it's an interesting way of benchmarking. They even make a good point here that it's not yet a rigorous approach. And then they also make a nice point here that building an evaluation system for chatbots remains an open question requiring further research. So this is definitely true at the moment, is how do you benchmark one of these language models against another? Because if you just run pure sort of evaluations on them, you can find that one model will respond to one way of prompting and give you a really good result. Another model with that same style of prompting will give you a really bad result, but with a different style of prompting will give you a better result than the first model. So it comes down to how do you work out the best prompting strategies for the different models. So that's also an interesting area of research at the moment that people are looking at. So they have a bunch of examples in here of comparing it. And so if we look at these, we can see that, okay, comparing alpaca to vicuna, the vicuna one is definitely generating longer text. And I'm not sure if that's always going to be a good thing or a bad thing. We know that ChatGPT tended to be very verbose with its generation, to the point where a lot of people wanted it to be shorter. And I think that's one of the things they were aiming for more with the GPT-4 stuff. But you can see here, we can just basically run different questions through. So you can look at some different questions and we can see the results that come out of these and see the comparison. And we can look at different models too. So we can look at the llama output. We can see that's really short. We can look at Bard's output if we open these up. And we can get a sense of how they compare, at least just through our own sort of eyes of which do we prefer, really, is kind of the way of going. One of the things that we haven't seen people do with language models as such, but people do with speech models, is do MOS scores, which are mean opinion scores, where with speech, it's probably quite easy. They would basically just say, oh, out of these two examples, which one was spoken by a human and which one wasn't? and they would build up scores that way. And that's a bit of a simplification, but it sort of gives you an idea. Maybe that's going to be one of the ways that people can do this with language models as well going forward. Anyway, so they've got this sort of way of benchmarking. They've got a nice write-up of the overview of how they did it. And they talk about that it's basically just fine-tuning. And the key thing here is this data set. And if we scroll down, we can sort of look at the different data sets. So we know Llama is the base model. So the Llama model, again, why are people using the Llama model? They're using the Llama model because it's built and it seems to do so well because it's got a trillion tokens that it's been trained on. When we compare it to other open source models that are out there that are trained on 300 billion tokens, even if they're bigger than the sort of equivalent Llama model, they just don't do as well. So this is definitely one of the key factors. But anyway, we've got Alpaca trained on Llama, Vicuna trained on Llama, obviously Bard and GPT not trained on Llama. So the Alpaca is trained with this 52,000 samples of the self-instruct style, whereas Vicuna is trained on 70,000 samples of conversations. And even you could think of these as being longer than 70,000 too, because they actually expand somewhere here. Yeah, so here they talk about they actually expanded out from being 512, which is what Alpaca was trained on, a sequence length of 512, out to 2048. And they do that by having multi-round conversations in there. So it could be like, I ask a question, I get the answer, I ask a follow-up question, I get the answer, I ask a follow-up question, I get the answer. That's all in one span in this. So it's definitely a lot more data that they're training on compared with the Alpaca in there. So they showed a little bit about, they've got their assessment of how they're doing this. And then they talk a little bit about the sort of costing of doing this too. So they've come up with a nice way of being able to use spot instances so that they can sort of change instances out, I guess. And that obviously reduces the cost for this. So anyway, you can go through and have a more in-depth look and it shows you this. The other interesting thing that came out around the same time, and we'll have a play with the model in a second, is this all this sort of controversy around ShareGPT. So ShareGPT last week tweeted out on their account, they basically tweeted out that they were taking down, somewhere here, they were taking down their explore page. One of the reasons why they were taking it down is because they believe that Google had been using this, that using the data on their site to train the Bard model. And so much so, an online site called The Information actually reported a story about one of Googler's researchers quitting over this. So this is a guy by the name of Jacob Devlin, and supposedly he quit after sharing concerns with Sundar Pichai, the CEO, and Jeff Dean, and another senior managers on the Bard team about the fact that they were using this data from ShareGPT, which was really data from OpenAI's ChatGPT. One of the things that makes the story kind of interesting is that perhaps hasn't been reported as much is who is this guy, Jacob Devlin? Well, it turns out he's a very good researcher. He's the first author on the BERT paper. So many of you will have heard of BERT. And this was one of Google's star models. It came out in 2018 and has been used in the search engines, but used in many different uses across Google and across industry in general. Set the tone for Roberta, for a lot of the other models that came along after it. And so it's interesting that if he's deciding to quit because of this, and we only know what people are reporting, right? I'm not saying any inside knowledge of this. And in fact, if we look at, you know, later on, Google denied that it was trained with, you know, that Bard was trained with ChatGPT data. So it could be that there are actually, for sure, there are multiple versions of Bard, and perhaps one of the early ones, they use that, and then the final ones, and they didn't, or I'm not sure. But they've come out very strongly and denied this and basically said that Bard is not trained on any data from ShareGPT or ChatGPT. Anyway, in regards to this, they took this down. ShareGPT took a lot of their data down. And this is what Vicuna was trained on, right? So Vicuna had a lot of this data, obviously, which they do talk about in here, that they basically converted to Markdown as a way to use it and stuff like that. And it does seem like that data turns out to be very useful. Again, though, this totally makes these models just not usable for commercial use, in that we've basically got Llama, which is not allowed to be used for commercial. We've got ChatGPT data, which is not allowed to be used for commercial. So they're nice to play with. And hopefully sooner or later, we will get an open source version of this that we can use commercially. But for now, that's not the case. Another interesting thing in this article, just quickly, is that it's kind of interesting, is they talk about DeepMind being pulled in to help with this project they're calling Gemini, which is trying to take on some of these language models. Now, that could be very interesting because DeepMind has actually done some really interesting work with language models already, and they built their own system called Sparrow, which again has never been released publicly. And one of the things it was that they were trying to incorporate with this was citations. So here's a blog post to go along with the paper for this that talks about what Sparrow is and some of the key things that they were trying to do to influence this. And some of these things are really interesting because if you think about things like everyone's talking about RLHF, right? Reinforcement learning from human feedback. I will make a video about that going forward. But a lot of those ideas originally came out of DeepMind and then got picked up at OpenAI, and they ran with them probably better than a lot of other places did. So it is interesting that if some of the ideas from DeepMind's Sparrow come out and get used, that could also make something really interesting. All right, let's have a play with the model. So here is the actual model. So as always, I've got the links in the description. You can come along and have a play with this. Here is the model. You can actually play with it, and they're actually serving it, and it seems to run quite quickly. So I've done a few different versions of playing with this. One of the ones I did was, I think I did this for GPT for all as well, where we asked it to write some limericks and it still didn't do that great. This definitely does seem to do a bit better for this. Not always, right? Sometimes it does well and sometimes it doesn't do well for this kind of thing. Another one that we used a lot was write an email explaining why GPT-4 should be open source. And you'll see that it's generating pretty quickly. And I would say that some of these things are definitely better than some of the other models that we've looked at. Now, the Raven one is interesting. It would be great to see the Raven model trained on this shared GPT dataset. I'll come back to this in a second. Unfortunately, that one of the things that they acknowledge here is that in their release, they have released code for training and serving and evaluating. They're planning to try and release the weights in some way, but there is no plan to release the data set. So the magic data set that they scraped before everyone else, unfortunately, it looks like it's not going to come out anytime soon. Anyway, you can see that this has done quite a nice email for this. Go along, have a play with this site and see for yourself what you think about it. Unfortunately, the model is not out yet. Perhaps when the model comes out, I'll look at how we could serve it ourselves and do stuff with it ourselves. But until then, have a play with it like this. As always, if you've got any questions, please put them in the comments below. I will try my best to go through and answer the comments in the first day or two after the video comes out. And if you found this useful, please click like and subscribe. I will see you in the next video. Bye for now.